getting started now, and we have up on the screen the title page. And so just for all of our, you know, right now with our Global Grand Rounds, we have our Toronto, Madrid, Boston offices all online with our clinical leadership nurses and case coordinators who are involved every day in the service of our members. And we are very, very fortunate. Oh, just want to remind folks to put themselves on mute if they are not presenting. And just wanted to take a quick moment to introduce Dr. Richard Zorowitz, who is the chairman of the Department of Physical Med and Rehabilitation at Johns Hopkins Bayview Medical Center. And he's been at Hopkins since 2006 as a medical director of the Pearsall Rehabilitation Unit. After serving as the medical director of the Pearsall Rehabilitation Unit at the Hospital of University of Pennsylvania. And now he is at Johns Hopkins with specific research interests in stroke rehabilitation outcomes, dysphagia, spasticity, and hemiplegic shoulder. So he has been been involved in the Pro-Stroke Rehabilitation Outcomes Project, sponsored by the National Institute for Disability and Rehabilitation Research. And so as we think about many of our members who come to us facing the complications of stroke and looking at management moving forward, we recognize that having a grasp of what people do and what their lives are like after a devastating stroke is tremendously valuable for us to understand. So we're very, very fortunate to have Dr. Zorowitz speaking with us today. And without further ado, let me turn over the mic to you, Dr. Zorowitz.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate everything you guys have done. I very much appreciate all the consultative work that I've been doing with you guys. It's always fun, challenging, and very intellectually stimulating to be able to do all this kind of stuff and, you know, hopefully answer questions and hopefully be of service to, you know, the people who come to Best Doctors for this kind of thing. So what I want to do over probably the next 45 minutes or so is to talk about advances in stroke rehabilitation. I call this from Axon to Zumba. If you go to the next slide, those are my disclosures. And just so you know, the other disclosure that I always like to say is that really there is no evidence that Zumba really helps stroke, except for, you know, for the exercise part of it. But the point I'm making by saying this is that what I want to try to talk about is some of the evidence, which there is not a lot of when you talk about stroke rehabilitation. So there's really a lot of room for you know, for a lot of research to be done, you know, over the next few years. But we have come a long way, and I'll tell you about a couple of studies, you know, that actually, you know, sponsored by NIH. And so if we go to the next slide, you'll see that's me at the Great Wall of China. I've done a number of trips over the last few years to China and to speak with them. But the reason this was actually rather interesting was because of, I think, some of the awareness that I didn't really know. Because if you go to the next slide, you'll see this wonderful sign that I saw at the Great Wall that says, "Heart, cerebral disease sufferer, ascend the Great Wall to please watch for." And it was really very interesting that, you know, they have this awareness for people with heart disease and stroke. And it just sort of, it took me by surprise, but very pleasantly so. So if you go on to the next slide then, this is what I'm going to be talking about over the next 45 minutes or so. We'll start off with some concepts of neuroplasticity, talk about the natural history of stroke recovery, timing intensity of treatment, current best practice, specificity of treatment modalities, potential treatment modalities, and then finally conclude with rehabilitation for health, talking about really the exercise benefits of rehab. So if you go on to the next slide then, neuroplasticity is, you know, as we have found out over the last, you know, really 10, 15 years or so with imaging techniques, we find that the brain is really not a static organ. It's very dynamic, and it's very much influenced by what we do in our daily lives. And when we do certain kinds of things, especially after stroke, you'll see things like, reversal of diastasis, which means, some of the damage that occurs remotely from the areas that where the stroke has occurred. And you also see activation of cell genesis and some repair of axons, although once those neural cells die, that's pretty much it. But the interesting thing about neuroplasticity is that we see that the neuronal pathways really do change, that even though the original equipment may be better, we do find that new pathways are established so that patients can improve their function and optimize their mobility and activities of daily living. And so by doing rehab, that's how we can really try to program the brain to be able to do more. And so some of the studies, if you go on to the next slide, have been done originally with animals. And the study I'm going to show you here is by Randy Nudo at Kansas, who basically takes monkeys and gives them strokes and then does some training and then does motor mapping to see what happens to the brains after these strokes. And so in this particular study, he looks at the representation of the uninjured brain and then basically gives them strokes and then trains them. In this case, what they do is they try to use the affected limb to grab pellets of food, so that with a lot of practice, you'll see changes in brain function. And so if you go to the next slide, that really just gives you, not the next slide. I did not put those, okay, so I unfortunately will just stay with this slide with Randy Nudo's stuff. So the pictures of them basically will show that if you do this training with patients, what you'll end up with is areas of brain that look very similar, although the orientation may be slightly different, but the surface area of the brain actually is somewhat similar. So when the strokes occur, that area decreases, and with training, then they increase again, and then you have you basically will have these nice little pictures, which unfortunately I guess I don't have on this particular slide set. If you go on to the next slide, another study that was done actually by Steve Zeiler, who's a colleague of mine here in neurology at Hopkins, what they also were able to demonstrate is that there are chemicals that may be able to help mediate what goes on in stroke. And so what he looked at were inhibitory markers, and what he did was to take mice and again to give them strokes after training them in a certain kind of activity, again, it may be a pellet kind of thing, and then retrain them once again to see what ends up happening with them. And so if you then go to the next slide, he looks at three different kinds of inhibitory markers, and those are parvalbumin, calretinin, and calbindin. And interestingly, what will happen is that when you give these mice strokes, you'll see these inhibitory markers increase in the brain. And when you train them again, it actually decreases the inhibitory markers, which basically shows that the brain is being more active when you're doing training and giving rehab. And then what they were able to do then is once again give them strokes a second time, and they showed that those inhibitory markers actually then increase again. So there are particular drugs or particular chemicals in the brain that actually could serve as markers that allow us to see whether or not we're having an effect with rehab activity. If you go on to the next slide, another thing that's being done is with imaging, and DTI basically stands for diffusion tensor imaging. And it's really rather cool because what you see are some pretty pictures where you can see, for the most part, white matter changes. So basically the tracks, between the cortex, heading down through the brainstem into the spinal cord. And so what they did in this particular study was to look at 25 patients who had aphasia. And based upon their classification, or based upon their severity of stroke and aphasia, divvied them up into three different classifications. One was where the arcuate fasciculus, which is the tract that connects Broca's and Wernicke's area, that's Broca's is where the expressive side of speech works, Wernicke's is where the comprehension side works. And so basically in group A, the arcuate fasciculus is not reconstructed, so these are people with very severe strokes. In group B, moderate aphasia, where the arcuate fasciculus is disrupted, but not fully, severed. And then finally, the mild aphasias, where the arcuate fasciculus is preserved around the lesion. And so, if you go on to the next slide. What they basically did was to do, this is done in Korea, so the KWAB is the Korean version of the Western aphasia battery. And what they did was they actually gave them batteries to take a look at how these things correlated. And as they found out, people who had relatively spared or mild aphasias basically scored significantly higher than the type A, which was the ones where the arcuate fasciculus was not reconstructed. What they also found was that there were no significant differences between types A and B and types B and C. But what it shows is that the people who have the more severe aphasias, actually you can see from an imaging standpoint how that affects those particular tracts. And so there are a number of different ways that we can look at those kinds of impairments, you know, with a number of different things. And if you go to the next slide, what they basically showed once again was when they looked at the late evaluations, which was about 3 months after stroke, types B and C were significantly higher than type A, but no differences between types B and C. So once again, there's some correlation between some of the imaging that's being done and what you see clinically. So, for the most part, you can see from these different things that there are a number of different ways that we can demonstrate not only how plastic changes can occur, but we can image to see whether or not some of the severity of the impairments that we see after stroke may correlate with some of the other things that go on and really get a better idea. So if you go on to the next slide, we'll be going on to the next section, and this is at the Mount Yuntai scenic area in the Henan province in China. It was, I thought, a very wonderful view from atop, and we actually went down to the below and took pictures from below as well. So going on to the next slide, let's talk a little bit about the natural history of stroke recovery, because now that we have some basis of why rehab occurs, we need to understand how stroke will recover after it occurs. So if you go on to the next slide, one of, I think, the classic articles that really gives a good description of this and gives some good pictures, and unfortunately I don't have those pictures here, is in an article by Pam Duncan, who published this article in 1992. And what they did was to look at Fugelmeyer scores, and Fugelmeyer is a scale that looks at motor impairment, along with the modified Barthel, and the modified Barthel is a functional scale. And if you look at the way that stroke naturally recovers, you'll see that it is a curve that has a high slope at the very beginning and then slowly begins to plateau. We don't like to say necessarily that things do plateau in the long run, because there are studies that have been shown that even months or even years after stroke, that you can have improvements with rehab training. But sometimes the question comes up when I'm seeing patients of is my arm going to work? Am I going to walk? You know, what's going to happen to me functionally? And often these occur like very much right in the neuro ICU, but even further down the road. So what this study basically shows is that after 5 days, that motor and sensory scores at that time can explain about three-quarters of the variance, which means after even 5 days, you can get some idea of what the trajectory of recovery is going to occur. But after 30 days, it actually goes up to 86%. And that's pretty significant because if you go back to Thomas Twitchell's classic article in 1951, what he basically was able to observe in his study of 121 patients with hemiplegia is that patients who don't get arm function back or don't start getting arm function back within that first month are going to have poor prognoses. So really by the first month, we have a good sense of how that patient potentially is going to do. You need to remember, though, that ultimately this is a numbers game and that even people who do poorly at that first month still have the potential, although not as good a potential as people who do better than the people who do poorly. So if you then go on to the next slide, the question then becomes up, are there other things that might influence the natural recovery of stroke? And it's interesting because there is a factor called BDNF, or the brain-derived growth factor, which is identified as one of those signals that might orchestrate synaptic plasticity. And as it turns out in this particular study, what's been shown is that there are polymorphisms in this. So basically, there are potentially genetic influences that might sway how you recover after stroke. And so what they show here is that that this particular polymorphism of VAL66MET was actually associated with abnormal cortical morphology and actually a poorer prognosis. So what's really interesting about this is that not only do we see a natural recovery, but there may be genetic influences on how patients may recover after a stroke. And so maybe one day we might get that genetic test so that we can, you know, get some idea of, you know, whether patients, if they're, you know, mild, moderate, or severe, you know, that it might influence how ultimately they may recover. And if you go on to the next slide, what they did was to show with transcranial magnetic stimulation, which we can use as a not only as a diagnostic study but also as a treatment modality as well. What they found was there may be training-dependent increases in motor potentials and motor mapping. And that these are influenced by these genetic changes. And so basically they did find is that reorganization by transcranial magnetic stimulation was reduced in healthy subjects with this polymorphism as compared with signal or people without that polymorphism. And so, again, there may be markers that actually might influence the way that people can naturally recover after stroke. So it's not one size fits all, but as we know, stroke rehabilitation is very much a very individualized thing. It depends upon the patients. It depends on their genes. It depends on their motivation, and then their natural recovery. So if you go on to the next slide, wonderful slide of monks doing kung fu. And just so you get a sense, that bamboo is actually really bent, and the tip of it is actually in the neck, and there's some pointed ends on it. And just to show how how much control these monks can develop after starting kung fu. So moving on, let's talk a little bit about timing intensity, and that's the next outline slide. And so we've talked a little about neuroplastic changes. We've talked about the natural history. So then the question really becomes one of when do we start rehab and how much do you do? And if you go on to the next slide, it turns out that timing and intensity of stroke is a very individual thing because, number one, some patients can't really, tolerate starting rehab, right at the get-go, and then other patients, can only do a certain amount of rehab just because of the severity of their stroke or maybe comorbidities like COPD, congestive heart failure, and other things along those lines. But the question really comes up, you know, how much rehab and intensity may speak to the effect of, you know, how long do you do it for, what's the frequency, so how many times a week are you doing this, and then how many minutes or how many hours per day do you do rehab? So just like taking a pill, you know, the dosing of rehab may have some effect on how well a patient will recover. And so this study by Gert Quackel, which was a meta-analysis, basically shows that intensive stroke rehab, for the most part, there is a small effect size within the first 6 months. And if you go on to the next slide, what they demonstrated was that you needed at least a 16-hour difference in treatment times between experimental and control groups. So not a large difference, because this is provided within the first 6 months, but what it does show is that there is some potential benefit from doing more rehab with patients as long as they can tolerate it, as opposed to if you have patients who can't do it as well. So if you then go on to the next slide, the question then becomes, when do you start? And then we'll answer the question after that of, you know, can you do intensive therapy right from the very get-go and very early? But this particular study by Sunseth looked at just a small population of patients who started their rehab and started mobilization within 24 hours after hospitalization. And looked at, you know, how well do patients do 90 days after stroke. And what they were able to show was that patients who started within 24 hours actually ended up had a trend, although not statistically significant, but had a trend towards increased poor outcomes, death rate, and dependency if they did that early mobilization. So it really brings up the question, although this is a very, very small patient population, of, you know, really, do you start patients right off the bat? And I think my theory behind it is, just like there can be spinal shock, there certainly can be brain shock, where in which there really is a period of time that you probably should let the brain rest and try to recover a little bit, because if you do that, that extra stress and strain on the brain actually will end up causing more damage than it will help the patient. So it's just some very interesting food for thought. The next slide, we're going to actually skip the next slide, because the next slide is actually the same thing as that other slide. I just realized I put duplicate slides in there, but so we'll go on to the next slide, which is the Nancy Latham study. Now, this, as was mentioned at the very beginning, I participated in a project called the Post-Stroke Rehabilitation Outcomes Project, which was a study that used seven different sites, six in the U.S., one in New Zealand, and looked at nearly 1,200 patients. And what we did was we created this database of what patients do in real time during their rehab. And then we went through each discipline, PT, OT, and speech, to take a look at, you know, what were the factors that might influence a better outcome. And so one of the questions that was asked was, how well does a patient do with ambulation after stroke, and what are the factors that might help? And so what we were able to demonstrate, at least in this real-time study, is that patients who spent a majority of their time doing gait activities actually did better in gait. So there's a number of different ways we put this. So, you know, Nike has it right, saying just do it. And then, of course, my adage of how do you get to Carnegie Hall, practice, 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 is really very relevant here. So the idea of trying to do something task-specific to gain mastery of a specific activity is very, very important here. And so what we looked at was, if you were to combine and basically make therapy time contiguous, instead of 1 hour the first day or a couple hours the second day and all that, if you put it all together, and we looked at the first six-hour treatment block, what we found was that if you actually spent about one quarter to at least one-third of PT time doing gait activities, that actually influenced the outcome. And then further on, as you mastered those certain types of activities, you did more advanced activities as well. Interestingly, though, what we did find was that even though we did a lot of household types of simulations, there was not a lot put into community simulations, which is something that also is very, very important as well. If you go to the next slide, Lori Richards basically did the same thing on the OT side, and basically what she showed in terms of looking at, say, bathing and dressing was that the majority of time spent in doing these basic activities of daily living would influence their outcomes as well. And just like walking, you started with basic activities and started to go towards more advanced types of activities, again, showing that little time was spent with community types of activities and leisure activities, although the patients who did better probably received those higher-level activities. So the idea of trying to move patients into those activities and being able to let them practice it is a very important aspect of these kinds of things. And again, you know, so the question is of course, then what happens with intensity? And again, the suggestion is that the more you do of these particular activities, the more likely the patient is going to do well. So if you move on to the next slide, then the question becomes, if you're going to take this intensity, we sort of looked at beforehand to say, you know, that starting early may be detrimental. This sort of puts this all together. And Alex Dromerk, who's now at the National Rehab Hospital in D.C., basically, again, looked at a very small population of patients that were randomized now like 9 or 10 days, not the usual, you know, 24 hours as we saw in the previous study, but looked at these patients at least 10 days out and randomized them into a regular rehab group and then a more intensive rehab group using some of the concepts that we see in constraint-induced movement therapy, which I'll talk about in a little bit. And after randomizing, they were able to show that these patients did well and were all equal when they looked at the arm reaction action test, which is a functional test that looks at a number of different activities and looks at quality of movement as well as the efficiency of movement. And if you go to the next slide, what they were able to show is that when you divided these patients up into more intensive and less intensive types of therapies, it actually demonstrated that the high intensity, and this is really more than what we normally give these patients in terms of their 3 hours of therapy, that the high intensity group basically had significantly less improvement than the other groups. And patients who had dose match, which basically means it was more of a directed type of rehab protocol as opposed to maybe conventional rehab, those two groups basically did significantly better than the high-dose constraint-induced movement therapy group, but there were no differences between those particular groups as well. So what this basically suggests is that high intensity, that intensity is a good thing, but too much of a good thing may not be good. And so really what it comes down to is what, you know, is really good for the patient, you know, and what really is the dosing, which we really don't know what is going to be the optimal dosing of therapy, you know, for all these patients. And so it really, you know, it really leaves a lot of unanswered questions in terms of what do we do you know, with our patients overall. So if you go on to the next slide, this is a study that looks at the other end of this, that, you know, it actually looks at what do we do real time with patients. And this is a study by Julie Bernhardt, who in Australia, you know, looked at clocking patients and seeing what they were doing during their day when they're in inpatient rehab. And again, small patient population, and looking at these 10-minute intervals between 8 and 5, what she was able to observe was that these patients spent about half the time resting in bed, about a fourth of the time sitting out of bed, so about 75% of the time, you know, basically probably doing not a whole lot of anything, and about 1/8 of the time engaged in activities to prevent complications and improve mobility. And overall, about 60% of this time was spent by themselves without anybody around. And so what this demonstrates is probably at the other end is that, you know, are we doing enough for our patients in inpatient rehab? Is it good, you know, to give patients things to do? You know, but again, the question is how much of a good thing is a good thing? And so once again, you know, if you look at all this timing and intensity stuff, it really leaves a lot of questions unanswered in terms of what's best for our patients. I mean, if you ask me, obviously I think this is a very individualized thing. Some patients can tolerate more than others, but then you have to watch about the fatigue factor and other things along those ideas. So if you go to the next slide, basically, you know, earlier, more intensive therapy to some degree will improve benefits of rate and extent of recovery. You know, usually wanting to wait, you know, about 24 hours is not necessarily a bad thing. On the other hand, we can see improvements even over many years of after stroke, and I'll show you that data in a little bit. But the question really comes down to, you know, can we be underdosing patients? Can we be overdosing patients? And what really is the optimal dose? And so those are questions that need to be answered. Next slide is a picture of around the Shaolin Kung Fu Temple, which I showed you before. But I thought this was just a really spectacular view of a very tall mountain that was near a place where earthquakes actually occur. So it was near a fault, and I just thought this was really very, very spectacular. So if you then go to the next slide, we're going to talk a little bit about, very briefly, about best practices. And so I think you can get the sense that, you know, is there really a best practice? And I think the answer to that, for the most part, is that we're really not sure what best practice is going to be. Looking at the following slide, what we do know is that the most effective therapies are based upon task specificity, as I showed you before. If you want to walk, practice walking; dressing, practice dressing. But the problem is, as you can see, that guidelines are basically very limited. The problem is that, as you can see from many of the studies I'm showing you, they're relatively small populations, probably not well-powered. A lot of the parameters that we're using, you know, can be very varied amongst these studies. And so the result is that there's not a good amount of supporting data that allows us to demonstrate what's really good, you know, what's the best thing since sliced bread. But if you, again, you ask my opinion, if you go on to the next slide, I think what we will ultimately show is that that stroke rehab is really akin to a Chinese menu. I think we're going to find that there are a lot of different things that we can do with patients, but the key is going to be finding stuff that engages the patient to want to do activity, and then after you've done that, then to make sure that the patient is doing, you know, an optimal amount of it, although we still really don't know what that optimal amount really is going to be. If you go to the next slide, this is a picture of the pool from the Beijing Olympics 6 years ago, where Michael Phelps, one of our Baltimore natives, you know, won all his gold medals, so rather cool. So if we go to the next slide, then we'll talk a little bit about really some treatment modalities that have been proven, and then we'll go on to talk about potential treatment modalities. And if you go on to the next slide, you know, really treatments can be grouped into two types, and those are the technological, those are the high-tech types of things, which we'll talk about, robots, virtual reality, the things that really require high-tech machinery, versus the non-technological, which is, we'll talk about constraint-induced movement therapy, as well as other things that are really more hands-on kinds of activities. And so the questions really are that most treatments, you know, share common underlying objectives and principles, largely, you know, that they hopefully allow patients to practice of movement and activity. But the question really is, one approach more appropriate than another? And if so, what makes it so? You know, again, I think really the basic principle is that patients, you know, who can engage in a certain activity will be the ones who are motivated and will end up doing well in the long run. So if you go on to the next slide, there are two studies that were NIH funded. This is the first of the, which is Steve Wolf's constraint-induced movement therapy. And actually, constraint-induced movement therapy is a concept that's been around for quite a while, that was actually started by Ed Taub at the University of Alabama at Birmingham. But this was a study that was ultimately published in 2006. What they did was they divided 222 patients into two groups. One got conventional rehab. The other one got constraint-induced movement therapy. And constraint-induced movement therapy in this case consists of immobilizing the unaffected limb, usually in a sling, and then putting a mitten around the hand, and basically forcing the patient to use the affected limb. And what they did in this case is to have the patient doing 6 hours of therapy over a 10-day period, and just basically, you know, working from basic activities and trying to work up to more advanced activities. And what they showed was that after the treatment period, that there were significant differences in improvement with the patients who got constraint-induced movement therapy. But moreover, what they also were able to show was that after 12 months, that those greater improvements actually were maintained by the Wolf motor function test, a motor activity log, so basically a more formal test as well as a log kept at home in terms of the types of activities that were being done. So a really very interesting study in terms of intensity. And by the way, these were patients who had their strokes months or even years prior. So again, it demonstrates how even after a long period after a stroke, that a patient can actually make some functional improvement. If you go on to the next slide, the other study that was done NIH funded was Pam Duncan again, who did the LEAPS trial. And what this was a study where she used partial weight support treadmill training after stroke for walking. And what she did was had three groups, one which was early, just a couple of weeks after the stroke occurred, one which was late, that waited till about 6 months afterwards, and then conventional therapy. And then compared all these patients after the interventions were done. And unlike constraint-induced movement therapy, what she basically demonstrated that was at 1 year, all participants had improved their walking ability, but when looking at all the outcomes measures, found that there was no difference between groups in terms of walking speed and some of these other outcomes measures as well. There were some serious adverse events noted, but, you know, the interesting thing was it didn't matter what you did with these patients, whether they got early treadmill training, late treadmill training, or just conventional therapy. They all did well, and there were no real differences. However, if you go on to the next slide, the interesting thing that they found, and this is a study that looked at this, that was published in Stroke in 2012, was that patients who got the early treadmill training and had walking speeds that were less than 0.4 meters per second, which is a marker of severe impairment, what they found was that those patients had the highest risk for falling. So, interestingly, and maybe not surprisingly, what they found was that patients who had more severe impairments, if you tried to get them going, they actually had a higher risk of falls. So again, the question becomes one of, you know, in these particular patients, do you necessarily teach them how to walk at this early stage, or do you provide, you know, much more safe measures for them, you know, so that you can reduce their, you know, their fall risk. You know, again, it really asks a lot of questions that need to be answered as well. But what they did find is that if they use the Berg Balance Scale, and again, the Berg Balance Scale is a very nice, reliable, valid scale that looks at balance, what they were able to show was that under a score of 42 over 56 total points, which basically tells us that patients are at risk of falling, that seemed to be the single best predictor of patients who had multiple falls with injury. But what they also concluded was this was not the only potential risk factor as well. So again, you know, this really, I think, asks a lot more questions than it may answer, and so a lot of things that need to be looked at. Going on to the next slide, then there are a number of things that, you know, that are being studied currently, one of them being functional electrical stimulation. Right now there is a study by Bioness that looked at an upper extremity functional electrical stimulation unit. But currently what we find is that the research behind all these things for both upper and lower extremity functional electrical stimulation are not good. The data needs to be better, larger studies, more standardized outcomes measures. And then the question really becomes of, you know, is there a type that's most effective? You know, and the questions that we've asked before, what doses? And, you know, so the timing of doing this and the intensity of doing this is all very, very important. So if you go on to the next slide, we're going to talk a little bit about robots. And again, these are the high-tech devices, and there are a number of them out on the market right now. If we look at upper limb robot devices, once again, you know, the data is not good. Because of the variation between studies, it is hard to really come up with a good meta-analysis to show whether or not these studies, you know, demonstrate a significant effect in impairment and in function. And so the result is, once again, you know, we have to look at, you know, what's good, you know, what kinds of things are good, when do you start, how much are you doing, and then what patients do you do this with. If you go to the next slide, for lower extremity robots, it's the same deal. You know, although those not able to walk seem to benefit most, but once again, we have to look at, you know, the timing of these things, the duration of these things, the intensity of these things, and then look at long-term outcomes to see whether patients really benefit, you know, from doing these things or whether conventional therapy, as Pam Duncan's study showed, you know, really doesn't make a whole lot of difference. So if you go on to the next slide, we're going to go into talking about some potential treatment modalities. So these are a lot of different modalities that, again, small studies and a lot of work needs to be done. And if you go on to the next slide with this, the key feature with a lot of these things, as opposed to the robots, the functional electrical stimulation, all that other stuff, is that these tend to be activities that, when they're combined with training, may be most effective. And again, the idea is to get patients to engage in these activities, get them motivated to do them, and then get them to do a lot of these kinds of things. So if you go on to the next slide, there are four basic modalities I'm going to very briefly discuss. One, the first is motor imagery, and motor imagery is nothing more than really thinking about it. And this is something that athletes do. They may think about what they're going to do before they actually do whatever action. And there are some small studies that demonstrate that this may be actually helpful to improve function over the long term. Another potential modality is bilateral arm training. And what this does is basically using both arms in a mirror fashion to be able to either try to stimulate the brain to be able to use both sides and to build some of the neuroplastic changes that we tend to see with intensive training. a similar type of therapy for this is mirror therapy. And what the difference here is that rather than the patient actually seeing both arms in action, what they'll do is actually put a mirror in the midline with the mirror facing towards the unaffected side so that it appears that the affected side is in fact unaffected. And what this does is to try to trick the brain to be able to think that the unaffected side is more functional and hopefully stimulating some of the neuroplastic changes that are required to improve function over time. And then finally is virtual reality, and virtual reality can be video games or whatever. It's basically putting those 3D glasses on and putting patients into environments that allows them to, you know, to see things and maybe, you know, do activities that have impact on, you know, what they're seeing. So I always say the Angry Birds kind of thing, you know, shooting things, you know, going through doors, trying to go down ski slopes, whatever, you know, may allow us, you know, to, you know, target certain types of activity that ultimately will help the patient improve in function. And by doing that, you know, it actually may cause some of the neuroplastic changes that we expect to see. So if you go on to the next slide, other potential modalities, I've talked about transcranial magnetic stimulation as a diagnostic modality for motor mapping, but it is also used as a means by which we can try to stimulate the brain to function, and there are certain types of stimulation that may help the unaffected side. The problem is right now is in this meta-analysis on the Cochrane collaboration, what they've demonstrated again is that the evidence doesn't support the use of routine use of repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation right now for stroke. Again, we need larger studies. Timing, intensity, all this kind of stuff is going to be very, very important, you know, to be able to figure out whether this is, you know, whether this is these are good modalities. If you go to the next slide, another similar kind of modality is called transcranial direct current stimulation, or TDCS. And again, this is basically actually hooking up electrodes and putting, you know, a certain amount of current, not the kind like you might see in, you know, electroconvulsive therapy for depression, but basically putting, you know, a small amount of current through and trying to help stimulate the brain. Or in certain cases, if you go on the opposite side, helping to inhibit the brain to allow the affected side to be more active. But again, the evidence is of very low to low quality. And again, you know, there's a lot of things that we have to look at to be able to see whether patients will tolerate it, as well as the fact of, you know, what is the dosing of all these things. So it's a very interesting modality that it may be that might be helpful. And so these are two things between transcranial magnetic stimulation and TDCS, you know, that are non-invasive but might have some impact, as opposed to some of the studies I've participated in where we actually did craniotomies and put electrodes on the dura itself. That's a whole different story that I will not go into today. Next slide. There are other ways we can do this non-invasively, and that's with drugs. And so drugs that increase central noradrenergic activity may enhance recovery, and that decrease noradrenergic activity may impair recovery. There are also other types of drugs that we can use. Those are dopaminergics, serotonergics, and things like that that may help to affect brain chemistry and, again, may affect some of the neuroplastic changes. So if you go to the next slide, basically four drugs that we look at, dextroamphetamines being the classic drugs that have been studied both in animals in the Havda article and in humans in the Walker-Batson article. The Walker-Batson article is really very interesting because not only did we see that in a small study that dextroamphetamine actually helped improve function during the course of it, of administration, but even afterwards, there were improvements in brain in function as well. Levodopa, which is Sinemet, essentially has also been used, and the study by Scheitman in The Lancet is something that I was doing a lot of prior to the last study, which we'll talk about, but that was basically putting a small amount of levodopa and carbidopa once a day to try to see if we can improve motor function, because, again, in a small study, it showed that there was potential benefit for doing that. Methylphenidate or Ritalin or Concerta are also drugs that have been used not only for motor recovery but also for attention and memory. And again, there may be some benefit, and these are old studies that demonstrated potential benefit. But the final study in fluoxetine, which was published a couple of years, 2 or 3 years ago, showed in a larger randomized clinical trial that there was some potential that fluoxetine actually might influence motor recovery as well. So actually, that's the drug of choice at this point for most of my patients with stroke. And so that's again, I think, there is some data. I think more data needs to be collected in terms of its efficacy. So you can see that there's a lot of different ways to go about this. There's high-tech ways, low-tech ways, medications, electrical stimulation. So most of these things are, very important. And as I said, there may be a combination of these things to be able to help the process of rehab along. So if we go on to the next slide, this, of course, is a panda at the Beijing Zoo, which was just kind of fun. So the final thing I want to talk about on the next slide is just rehab for health, which is cardiovascular and metabolic issues. So one of the things that we don't talk about a whole lot is, we talk about function, but then we don't talk about what really also is the benefit of exercise. And obviously the benefit of exercise is that it helps cardiopulmonary endurance. And so if you look at the next slide, which is this table of or this flow of lower limb cardiovascular training, you'll see that rehab helps recovery, but it also, if you do it at levels that that get heart rate up, you can build cardiopulmonary capacity, which ultimately, put the two of those things together, improve functional capacity and improve activities and participation, which ultimately to the patient improves quality of life. And also decreases the risk of stroke and heart problems in the long run. So if you go to the next study, a meta-analysis that was done in the stroke in 2011 showed 9 studies, 426 patients, showed that exercise can have a small to medium effect on health-related quality of life measures post-intervention, but not at follow-up. And I think the reason maybe at follow-up is you have to ask the question of whether the patient is motivated to continue doing these exercise programs on their own. The key is that there's no adverse events, but really the question comes down to is, can you get patients to do this? And this is, I think, a global question that we have in terms of anything in rehab, because patients in a structured therapy environment, have sort of that crutch named the therapist to work with, but when that therapy stops, it's really up to the patient, and then it becomes their responsibility to be, to be active and trying to continue trying to do as much functional activity as possible. So our challenge is, how do you get patients effectively to sustain, these activities, and then does this help to sustain some of these effects that we see after interventions? So some of the ways on the next slide that we can do this is either with treadmills. If patients don't have good balance and can't walk, you can do recumbent bikes, recumbent steppers. So there's a number of things that can be done for stroke survivors that accommodate their impairment. So the key here is making sure that we are, very active, not only engaging our patients and getting our patients engaged, but also being the cheerleader so that when therapy ends, that they can continue to do what they need to do to at least maintain their level of function, if not to improve on it. So that's largely what I have to say, and we are coming up to the top of the hour. So what I've talked about over the last 50 minutes or so is that we do have a volume of work, on neuroplasticity, on recovery, on timing intensity, rehab, and it's growing, but there's still a lot more that we need to do. And we need to understand, not only on the larger research level, but on the individual level as well, and what are the factors that influence each individual. And so the factors of looking at task-specific training, so the types of activities that really help patients over the long run. When do we start? How much are we doing? The benefits of aerobic training, you know, all have to be factored into routine care and are things that, you know, ultimately are going to benefit our patients. And so, really, we need to do a lot of things between the lab and the clinic so that we better understand the whole black box called stroke rehabilitation, but ultimately it'll benefit the patients. It improves and optimizes their function, and ultimately will give them a better quality of life so they can, you know, enjoy the kinds of activities and hopefully get them back to doing the things that they like to do. So with that, as it says here, visit is over. So I guess I have a couple of minutes or whatever, and I'm assuming if we need to, we can take some questions. But thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Dr. Zorowitz. You know, as you know from the case reviews that you've done, so often these questions of prognosis and how to optimize long-term outcomes are brought to us. So providing a framework like this is very, very helpful. And I know there's probably, you know, few folks with burning questions, but let me open it up in the last couple of minutes. Any questions from folks either who are remote or in Madrid or Toronto? I'm sorry. And you know what? I think we just need to quickly unmute people because we were just give us a sec. Actually, so while we unmute people, I had one quick burning question.
And it makes it challenging because it's not clear enough. And then some people write one thing and somebody writes something else and... Yeah, I know where you're coming from.
Okay, that might not have been a question. So, no, one question, you know, you went through so many different variables that can affect outcomes. Is there any, have people seen any impact of the mechanism of stroke on ultimate outcomes, you know, embolic versus hemorrhagic versus ischemic for, you know, if there's a certain given initial area of infarction or degree of functional impairment, does the mechanism of stroke affect long-term outcomes?
So yeah, I'm sorry because if I had had the slide, if I had had the slide on Pam Duncan's original study, which is the slide around number 15, great pictures on that. And basically, what it comes down to. As I like to put it, the worse you are, the worse you are. So mostly, if you have it really builds on severity of stroke. The more severe the stroke, the likely that your outcome is going to be more severe. Pam's article really shows very nicely that, you know, you have that high slope that slowly begins to plateau off. But if you look at it, if you look at mild, moderate, and severe, they're pretty parallel in terms of if you start very severe, you'll make improvements, but you're still not going to quite be as good as the moderate, and you're still not going to be as good as the mild. And so a lot of it just takes, experience. So if I have a patient, you know, who's really very, very seriously impaired and needs rehab, you know, the first question I'm going to ask them is, you know, the likelihood that they're going to need help is there, you know, is there family help that's going to be able to, you know, assist that patient when that patient goes home eventually. So I think that's really it's really more the severity as opposed to, you know, whether it's embolic, whether it's thrombotic, whether it's hemorrhagic.
Okay, excellent. Well, thank you so much, and I know that we're actually past the top of the hour, and folks are coming into our main conference room. So thank you again so much, Dr. Zorowitz, and look forward to continued collaboration.
And I appreciate it, and thank you very much for listening.